Good afternoon, everybody. I'm sorry, I don't know how to download this background. But I would like to give a warm welcome to Dr. Shivram. I've known him for so many years. He is doing a thankless job of being editor-in-chief of the Global Journal of Transfusion Medicine, and rightly so, because he's published so many papers and in national and international journals. He's a principal assessor and ex-TC member of NABH also. Invited members to so many of our NACO, NBTC, KSBTC, and so on. And what is more, he's an honorary fellow of the Society of Regenerative Medicine. That's something new, I think, for many of us over here. Welcome, Dr. Shivram.
Thank you.
Dr. Shivram, now
Do we
we can take.
start?
Yeah, sir. Please, Dr.
Okay.
Shivram, now you can take over from this.
Okay, one second. I need to share my. I've got a set of questions which I need to share. Okay. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Okay. So, good afternoon, everyone. So, on this esteemed panel, we have one gracious lady, which you can see on the screen, Dr. Sangeeta Pathak. And to counter her, we have three gentlemen, Dr. Prashant, Dr. Ravindra, and Dr. Amit Agarwal. Since there are more men than women, we hope to have a discussion. So, let's get on with the discussion. So before that, there's a short. Yes. Somebody wanted to say something? No offense meant to any women. I'm only saying one woman are equivalent to three men.
Exactly. Equal. More than
That I'm
Anna.
going to prove it also, don't worry.
So this is Dr. Sangeeta Pathak, who needs no introduction, Secretary AATM, Secretary ISBTI, NABH Assessor, Member TRG Group NBTC. Her area of expertise, NAT and apheresis, and of late, her recent achievement has been that she was the first to start convalescent plasma therapy. She is the recipient of many awards like the J.J. Jolly Award, Dr. Usha Gupta Award, Sushruta Award, Karmveer Corona Warrior Award, and she has five chapters to her credit in various textbooks, 17 publications, four editorials, and we keep asking her to write more and more in future. So thank you. Welcome to Dr. Sangeeta.
Thank you.
Dr. Prashant, whom we all know very well, he is the MD in transfusion medicine with postdoctoral certificate course in apheresis and component therapy, over 20 years of teaching and research experience, many scientific publications, had the H.D. Shaury Award in 2011 for transfusion medicine. He was member of the first technical committee of NABH Blood Bank, which drafted the standards. He is currently principal assessor for NABH Blood Bank. Received many fellowships, including one from the United Nations. He's an executive committee member of ISTM. Welcome, Dr. Prashant.
Thank you so much for your kind words.
Then we have Dr. Ravindra Singh, popularly known as RP, with MD Transfusion Medicine again. He also has a fellowship from UK. He has 21 years of rich national and international experience in transfusion medicine. He has research projects in the stem cells and regenerative medicine, rare antigen phenotyping, and including registry of multi-transfused patients. Welcome to Dr. Singh.
Thank you, sir.
So then we have the last but not the least, Dr. Amit Agarwal, senior consultant at Fortis Escorts, New Delhi. Again, MD in transfusion medicine, unlike the old timers. He has many papers and posters in national and international conferences, numerous publications. He's the recipient of awards, fellowship of international repute. He's the joint secretary of publicity for AATM, also my co-editor in JJTM. He's also an NABH assessor. So welcome to Dr. Amit. With this, let us begin the today's panel discussion, which is about quality assurance in TTI testing. As you all know, quality assurance in TTI is a process which starts with the donation of blood and involves several steps, like sample collection. Having collected the sample, it has to be labeled properly. It has to, up until the time of storage testing, it has to be stored properly. If these things are not taken care of, then you're not going to get quality ultimately. So all these things are important. then we have we need to use validated processes and for TTI testing. And by this process, I don't mean the process of TTI testing per se. This should also include infection control and biomedical waste disposal. And you also know that there are several chemicals that are generated during TTI testing. So it also includes chemical waste disposal. Finally, once the assay is complete, what is more important is who interprets the assay, how it is interpreted, and in today's world, how is it transcribed either to a hard register or to another soft copy into some software. So these are the things involved in TTI testing. So today I thought we will divide the discussion looking at the elements of various TTI testing. So TTI testing involves a method, which is nothing but a protocol, a process, and procedures, all these need to be correct if you need quality. Then you need the right kind of equipment, or by machine, I mean the right equipment for doing the test, properly calibrated and validated. Then just the method and machine are not enough. We need the right manpower, trained manpower, qualified manpower, who are competent to do the test and interpret the results. Then you need a good quality reagents, tested by yourself. Then you need to measure or interpret the results correctly. Then finally, to do all these things, your reagents, machine, everything, you need a good environment, which I have referred to as the Mother Earth. So I begin today's panel discussion with the methods. Let me start with the lady on the panel, Dr. Sangeeta. Dr. Sangeeta, what are the TTI testing methods available? And how do you think they compare? What do you recommend should be the methods to be used in a blood bank?
Okay. So right now we have a number of methods there with us, like the rapid card method, the ELISA, the ECLIA, and the NAT method. So the rapid card is the immunochromatography. ELISA is the enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. CLIA is the chemiluminescence assay, immunoassay, and nucleic acid amplification testing is the NAT. So if I just compare them around, the first method, that is rapid, is a manual method, while ELISA can be manual, automated, and semi-automated, all three of them. CLIA is mostly what I've seen is an automated method. It is not a manual method. And NAT, again, can be manual and automated both. Then the turnaround times for rapid cards definitely is very less, 15 to 20 minutes. ELISA is definitely more, 150 minutes. Then CLIA, 55 minutes is the perfect time, which is there for testing so many things. And NAT, a minimum of 5 to 6 hours, whether you use any of the available methods that are there. Then the technology that is involved is an age-old technique with rapid, same with ELISA. And in CLIA, it is an advanced technique, which involves the formation of those wells with beads and gels. And NAT could be a TMA-based method, or it could be a PCR-based method. Then accuracy is, with rapid cards, you all know, it is variable. With ELISA, it could be variable, CLIA, accurate, and reproducible, and NAT, definitely it is accurate. Then the sensitivity with rapid would be definitely low, and as compared to the others, and the window periods covered would be only more with NAT as compared to all the other methods. Like the window periods are more covered in NAT, and these, though the window period is narrowed in CLIA also, but definitely they are not much covered with these two other methods. Then the technique of handling, means ease of use is more rapid, is a very easy method. Anyone can do it. ELISA needs a particular training. You can't just hand over a technician and say, go and do an ELISA. They can't do it. You have to train the person. CLIA, definitely automated, so very easy to use, but still needs training. And NAT definitely needs expertise. You can't just ask someone to walk in. It is automated, but still needs expertise. And even one which is manual definitely needs.
Thank you, Dr. Sangeeta. Thank you, Dr. Do you think there is, I have a follow-up question for you, Dr. Sangeeta. Do you think there is room for rapid testing in the blood bank today? Do you use rapid in your blood center? And if so, under what circumstances?
So rapid usually, at least in the centers which are based in big cities, I don't think so anyone is using, except, yes, there are exceptions to it. Like when, in my case, I don't use it in apheresis, I do not use this, but I use it at times because I have to use a fourth generation as per my Delhi state control organization, which has, means DSACS has told us to use a fourth generation. So at times when I'm unable to use the, means put up the NAT for my RDPCs, I do use it.
Okay. So yeah. The message is that rapid tests are never the preferred method to be used. Correct. Only an exceptional method. So let's move to the next panelist and the next question. The next parameter required for quality is, of course, the machine and the equipment. So let me ask Dr. Amit here. Dr. Amit, what do you think are the parameters that must be calibrated when doing an ELISA or CLIA? What are the parameters of calibration? This is for Dr. Amit.
Yeah, I'm audible.
Yes, Amit.
There are certain parameters needs to be calibrated in the case of ELISA or CLIA. First, it has to be done as per the by the third party or as per by the manufacturer. And whatever it has to be done, parameters needs to be checked. They need to be traceable as per NABL.
You are audible, Dr. Amit, but not louder. Can you be a little
Your
louder?
Your voice is low.
I'm saying, hello, am I audible?
Yes, better.
Yeah. No,
I'm saying ki parameters for calibration are as per the manufacturer instructions, and it needs to be done either by the manufacturer itself or by the third party using traceability equipments which are traceable. Parameters that are regularly calibrated, they need speed, temperature, volume, time, and optics, that is in the form of a reader, in the form of illuminometer in the case of CLIA, or reader in the case of ELISA. Or any other instructions as per the manufacturer, they needs to be calibrated well on time as per defined by the NABL guidelines.
Okay. The reason I asked this question was that when we go for assessments, we have noticed that some parameter or the other is often missed out during calibration when we go for NABL assessment. So it's probably a good idea to map the parameters of calibration for the all critical equipment and keep it with you, so that when a calibration is done, the same doesn't get missed out. Now, let me ask a follow-up question to maybe Dr. Prashant. Dr. Prashant, do you think the parameters of calibration for the NAT system are different from ELISA or CLIA, or they are almost the same?
Well, in my opinion, the parameters of calibration for a NAT system, as far as blood bank is concerned, we have hardly two platforms available in India, as we all know, for testing by NAT. So the speed, temperature, volume, time, etc., all these things have to be kept in mind. Moreover, for NAT specially, and NAT as such, not only limited to blood banking, WHO has given some guidelines. Like they have said that they are calibrators which are primary, secondary, and tertiary in nature. The primary calibrator are the international standards which are produced by WHO, and the secondary calibrators are derived from primary ones, and they are for the national level or a regional level. And lastly, the tertiary calibrators are for the particular labs or hospitals. So this is only for the antigen testing, not for antibody testing, as we do it with NAT, only antigen. So, and this, the details are available on the international WHO website /biologicals. If you are interested, you can read further in it.
Dr. Prashant, these parameters are based on the test to be conducted or the machine being tested? Machine being used.
It is the test being conducted.
Yes.
Calibration of
the
test.
So this is in addition to the machine parameters. Yes, you are saying calibrators can be used to test the machines.
Yes.
Depending on what assay you are doing.
Correct.
Okay. So we have covered two parameters. One is the methods of TTI testing. Then we have touched upon the calibration parameters in case of the machine or the equipment that we use. For paucity of time, we will go on to the next the parameter, that is the manpower or human resource behind the testing. So who will go for this question? I think we can ask Dr. R.P. Singh, who has remained silent for this question.
Yes,
Dr. R.P. Yeah. So who should do that? Who do you think should do the test? And who should interpret the results?
Yes, so basically the first, the staff, that is the technical staff, who should be trained to handle the TTI lab, the words of the machine, the procedure, the protocols, how to handle it, and where to store the reagent, and then the testing protocol and parameter, and well words of the standard operating procedures. So these are the frontline worker, the staff, they can do the initial testing for the TTI. And after the testing, the person that is in charge, we can say the medical officer, who are the like authorizing person and the certifying person. So medical officer is the source authority who can verify and certify the result. So this is the how manpower you can be like dedicated for the TTI test.
Okay. So I have no, that one of the doubts I had was when we said who should do the test, we go by the drug controller standards and say he should have a minimum qualification of DMLT or BSc MLT. This is just
basically, that is a DMLT who was approved by FDA, or BSc DMLT is ideal because those are better qualified, they have better understanding. But
MSc microbiology who has done ELISA, CLIA test, or let's say biotechnology who has done this test, can we take them in the blood bank?
As for the FDA norms, basically, we are not entitled to take them, although they are like well qualified and well experienced to handle the TTI testing. They're good for the laboratory testing, but for the transplantation blood center, only those are fall in the purview of the FDA norms and regulations. They are authorized to do the test.
Maybe our associations must push for this MSc microbiology, BSc microbiology, biotechnology, and these courses to be acceptable for testing. Okay, we will not spend time on legal aspects. So what do you think should be the elements of training for TTI? How will you assess the competency of your staff? Again, Dr. R.P. Singh can continue with this.
Right. So the kind of training, as I told you earlier, because the staff need to well versed of the like routine practices, the procedure, the policy, and regarding is taking all the testing protocols have to be covered under it. And including that, the storage and then reagent and then when to use it and how to like dispose of the waste generated, that is the liquid and waste, that's like part of the training protocol. And the staff also trained for how to like the statistical like assessment for to charting the E ratios, LJ charting, and accordingly the run the controls. So they can plot and they can be able to identify the where is the like test is going in which directions. So identification of the wrongdoing during the testing, they need to be identified and picked up by their own. So this is like the training to be required for all the technical staff, viewers deputed for the testing for the TTI. So this is like, we can do that's the basic requirement for the efficient staff they can do for testing. And once of the assessment, we can say there's an authorized the staff who can run the TTI testing. So authorization again one part to handle the testing for the and the machines as well.
How do you assess the competency?
So competency assessment we can do like in the form of oral like testing and the written testing, even giving a like a spike sample and unknown samples, they are not aware of that. And then they can do the repeat sample as well. So without their knowledge, we can give the samples and then let them run. And then we can find like any variation in the result or the result, what we did it earlier, they find similar. So in that way, we can be able to assess whether they're doing the right work or there's some deviation in the testing protocol. So these are part of their assessment. And like the exercises we can give, like the giving for some samples we can run, and we can ask them to calculate the E ratios, like run how to run the external quality control samples. So these are the part of training and assessment we can do. So then some like example, like exercises, spike samples, unknown samples to be given them, and the repeat sample, and then oral and the written examinations.
I think you have covered most of it. Maybe you can also look at the number of wastages that happens when a particular person does the testing, the number of times you have to do a repeat assay, the number of times there is failure of QC. All this could also be used to assess the competency. In addition to what you rightly mentioned, you have covered so many points. So let's go to the next question. This is about the materials or reagents that we use in TTI testing. All of us know that we test for five TTI markers, HIV, hepatitis B, HCV, syphilis, and malaria. We just believe the manufacturers and start using them. So let me ask Dr. Prashant here. Dr. Prashant, how do you think the quality of TTI reagents can be assessed before using them by any blood bank? What lot QC or batch QC should we be doing to make sure that the kits that we are using give us the intended results?
So I will start with the first question, that how do you assess the quality of TTI reagents? So when you receive a lot of reagents, lot means, I mean to say a lot of reagents. So you have to be assured that from the word go, the quality has been maintained. From the word go means, I mean to say that it is already approved by NIB. As we all know, initially NIB used to approve a TTI reagent once. Certification was given once, but now NIB tests and approves for every lot, for every new import. Secondly, the vendor himself evaluates the kit and gives a certification that it is ready for use and calibrated and it is quality checked. Thirdly, on receipt, you have to assess the physical condition of the reagents, whether they are damaged, any temperature, faulty temperature, storage problems, etc., transport problems. So those have to be checked on the receipt of the TTI reagents. And lastly, but not least, the performance evaluation. By controls, what you put, you have to evaluate the performance of that lot first and then put it into regular testing. The second question, that how do you do the lot QC for the TTI reagents, is we all know it's simple, that we use two kinds of samples. One is the known samples, which you have developed in your lab, maybe a borderline sample, a high positive, a high negative, these kind of samples, or you can also acquire commercial samples. Many quality schemes are running in the country. Those you can acquire from them, or many companies are also manufacturing these for commercial purposes. So this is how do you perform a lot QC.
Okay, so that's nice. You have tried to cover the assessment of TTI reagent, that their quality. Probably you will look at the approvals like the FDA, NIB. You can look at CE mark, all these things. Then you also spoke about doing a good vendor evaluation. When I was discussing once about vendor evaluation with a blood bank, I asked them, how do you do vendor evaluation? And they said, we will ask him, what is the cost? How many conferences will you sponsor? Will it be with me for alone or with my family? So apart from those things, you have covered quite a lot, like performance qualification and how to using controls. So, and then also you mentioned that you can buy samples from national reference laboratories. Unfortunately, I don't think these national reference laboratories are available in our country. Then we have, but WHO samples are available, though we don't use them because they're very expensive. But certainly, as you mentioned, we can use known positive, known negative samples, which we have built on our own to test our reagent kits. So, then I have a please explain to the audience, what is change control validation? Some of them may be new to this. And how do you incorporate the same into your quality management system?
Yeah. So change control validation comes into play whenever there are three things. Number one, when we want to change the equipment, when we want to change the technology, or when we want to change the lot. So before doing this change control validation, first assess why you want to change, then assess the impact of that change, and then document the expected outcome of that change. then only you have to start with that change. So now for documenting it, you have to first lay down the procedure. That is, there should be an SOP for this change control for this change control validation. Then you have to test and revalidate that particular test. Then the updation and validation of this document. And then whoever is doing this validation and updation and retesting, that is always a senior technician or a senior resident or a senior medical officer with you, he is then going to train these people, your junior technicians, to work on this. That is how this change control validation happens.
Thank you, Dr. Sangeeta. For paucity of time, we'll go quickly now. So the next question is about the environmental conditions that are required. Dr. Prashant, what do you think should be the right environmental conditions for doing an ELISA or TLIA?
Well, the environmental condition encompasses different things. Like as predicted in the slide, it may consist of physical things in form of segregation of testing areas. That is, you cannot perform TTI in the same area as you are doing your blood group serology or maybe immunohematology. There has to be a separate lab for TTI testing, as given by FDA also. And second comes the bio-waste management. This also is a strict norm for maintaining the recommended environmental conditions of bio-waste management. Third is the electrical support. Electrical support not only in the form of power backup, UPS, etc., but what kind of electrical support? Many big machines need three-phase power, some run on single phase. So you have to be prepared beforehand before setting up the power support. And the fourth point is the IT support with validated software. As in most of the hospitals nowadays, what we call hospital information services or the LIS in some places, there is always a software which is linked to the machine, which automatically updates the data or the results in the software, and then it can be viewed by different viewers of different sections. So you have to keep in mind that the software is compatible with the machine. Second last point is the ambient temperature and humidity as per manufacturing instructions. This is also very necessary because most of the machines work on an ambient temperature of around 22 to 24 degrees centigrade or as per manufacturer instructions. A common problem which is faced is, as I have faced in my problem in my lab also, that the lab temperature has to be between 22 to 24. But at that, now monsoons are there. The normal temperature in a room, 22, is the person feels cold. So it is difficult to maintain two types of temperature in two different rooms which are governed by a single AHU. So you have to look into that also. And last but not the least, the biomedical support in case of breakdown or preventive maintenance, etc.
Very nicely covered, Dr. Prashant. All the elements of that go into the environment have been covered. Now let me ask Dr. Amit. Dr. Amit, do you think the environmental conditions are same for NAT testing or are they vastly different? You are not audible. Maybe you are muted.
They are the same, sir. I am saying they are the same for the NAT testing as per the what Dr. Prashant has mentioned. Conditions and the recommendations remain the same for NAT testing also.
Okay, thank you. So we'll go to the next one. The next question, we'll come back to Dr. Prashant. What do you think is meant by cutoff for an ELISA or TLIA assay? What is E ratio? When we plot the E ratio, we say on LJ chart, what is this E ratio? And how is it different from a cutoff? So, Dr. Prashant?
Yeah. I would keep it short because this is a very huge topic to cover.
Yes, please keep it short. We are running out of time.
I will keep it short. And I'll be to the point, that is, what is cutoff for an assay in case of ELISA or TLIA? So cutoff, we all know, is the point or the line from which we define whether the sample is reactive or non-reactive. So that is the cutoff. And There is a gray zone also, we all know, above and below the cutoff. And what is E ratio? So coming to the E ratio, it is an important tool to assess the quality, and it is different from the cutoff because it does not define the reactors and the non-reactors. It is basically calculated by the OD value of the quality control sample or the external control sample divided by the OD value of cutoff. So this is how E ratio is quite different from cutoff.
Okay. So, how do you validate the assay and make sure that based on run to run, the assay is functioning properly? Let me ask this to Dr. Ravinder Singh.
So basically, validation, we can say once we are running the test, because the test is to be run with the internal control or the provided by the manufacturer and the kit controls. So along with the internal control, if we can incorporate external control, that's Dr. Prashant already said, because once we add a low positive control into the test, so along with the internal control, that is a kit control, because internal control, they have the property where, first of all, they are manufactured by the manufacturer and they are managed in that way. So even for the minor changes, this cannot be changed the value of the testing, whatever you're doing. So what if you take an external control, which are the low positive values, along with the internal control and the external control, and we are observing the values and we find whatever the test expected, we're getting the result. So we can say that result or run is a value. If it is find any differentiation between the external control values, so that indicator of that the test run is invalid, and accordingly we can assess it by different parameters in that. So
what do we understand by intra-run assay and inter-run assay?
Inter-run assay, we can say, so if you're running any one sample in triplicate and with a different ways with the same lot, and intra means that it two different log, you can run it. So that is a two different time. So three samples, sample and triplicates, we run in the another time, maybe in the another plate or another. And then we can see the result. And result can be calculated in the ways of coefficient variations. That is the standard deviation upon mean 200. And we can find if the CV value is less than 15%. So where we can say the coefficient variations can be
okay, thank you Dr. RP. So you have said that external controls, internal controls are important. It's important to do an intra-run repeatability and also check inter-run variation. Now I come back to Prashant and say there is a blood bank running external controls and internal controls but has no LJ chart. Will you take blood from this blood bank, Dr. Prashant? It doesn't have a LJ chart.
So most importantly, first of all, the answer is no. I personally would not take blood from blood center with no LJ chart. But the question is why? Why is it so important to have an LJ chart? So we all know what LJ chart is. LJ chart is a chart which depicts whether our TTI testing is taking place correctly over a period of time. It is not that one run specifically is correct or incorrect. It takes into account various runs on various, maybe a lab is performing three runs a day. So all three would be charted on the LJ chart. And this is a continuous process for maybe 20 days or 25, 30 days. So LJ chart is a beautiful tool for maintaining the quality of TTI testing. So this is the importance of LJ chart. That is how I would always prefer blood from blood center with
yes, I agree with you, Dr. Prashant. I think LJ chart is more important than NAC testing and those things. I have a follow-up question. Yes?
Sorry to interrupt. We are running late. Please.
Yes, we'll wind up in 2 minutes.
One minute.
Okay. When do you plot the values onto the LJ chart?
So, when do you think? This question, I think I have already covered. Okay. That you plot it on every run.
Okay.
Controls OD value on every run.
Okay. Dr. Sangeeta, let me ask you one question regarding LJ chart, the last question pertaining to this. What Westgaard rules do you use in your blood bank? Do you recommend?
The Westgaard rules that we apply is the four that have been shown here and a 10x rule also. So 1-2s rule is when one control measurement exceeds two standard deviations of the control limits, either above or below. So these means I suppose I'm not explaining them because there's no time.
So there's a lecture, follow-up lecture on this.
Yes, and the 10x which I've not shown here is the rule that rejects a control run when there are 10 consecutive controls on the same side of the mean. So these five things are to be followed with the Westgaard rules.
Okay, we'll just end up with one last question. So this is for the panelists as well as the audience. What do you think is the right time to do the TTI testing for apheresis? Before the procedure? B, before the procedure, but the reason is different. C, after the procedure, but before issue, just treat them like whole blood, but only have minimum inventory to issue blood. None of the above, any of the above.
Sir, I'll go for A.
Go for A, before the procedure. Anybody for B?
For the first time, you can do the like procedure. Those
I go for B.
Okay, what do I do? Okay. I go for C. We will leave the choice. No, I can't say anybody is right or wrong. It depends on the situation. So we will leave it for the audience to decide what they want to do. But I always wonder, why should we treat SDP different from whole blood? We need to have minimum inventory and probably treat it, give it the same respect as whole blood, not do rapid test and issue the most expensive product. So with that, I wish to thank all the esteemed panelists and the chairpersons, Dr. Lata and Dr. Jayashree, and also Ravi Darav, our moderator here. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. You
I wish to say one thing. Of course, we don't have the time, but otherwise, one important thing which should be covered along with this is donor notification. Of course, we don't have time. It's part of the quality management in this area. And I would like to thank Dr. Prashant specifically because he brought out the point about the validation of the software. Many of us don't even know about it. And we are not aware of it because it's in another area, not a medical this thing. But that's a very, very important point that has been covered. Thank you so much. That was a very interesting question answer session. And thank you to all the panelists and Dr. Shivaram.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Ravi. Thank you, Dr. Shivaram.
Thank you, all panelists. Thank you, Ravi. Thank you so much. That true, Dr. Lata, ma'am.
Yeah.
Proceeding further, sorry, we are running. Professor and head, said GS Medical College, KM Hospital. So please introduce our next speaker, Dr. Narendra Naidu. Dr. Jayashree, please.
Dr. Narinder Naidu, I know her for many years, and in fact, we have been colleagues together, and I'm very happy to introduce her, and I welcome her for this session. And she's going to talk on this important session now, the TTI session, regarding EHR. So she's MD Pathology and DTM in Transfusion Medicine, Diploma in Transfusion Medicine. And she worked as Assistant Professor and Lecturer in Sion Hospital, LPMD Hospital, for 5 years. And she's conducting IQAS program on TTI testing for various blood centers in India. And in fact, our KM Center is also a participant for this IQAS program. She's been trained by Australian Red Cross in quality management system, which has also been trained by NRN Australia for carrying out IQAS and TTI. She received the Travel Award by Australian Society for Hematology. She's a technical expert of NAPO, NABH and NABL SSRP. She's been a faculty for various workshops, conferences, and conferences conducted by MDAS. It has number of publications in international and national journals. So welcome, Dr. Narinder, for this session.
Thank you, Jayashree, for your kind words. I'm indeed grateful to the organizers for having invited me to speak on a topic which is so dear to us, because we have worked so many years in TTI, and it's a pleasure to be talking. So without wasting any more time, I will start my...
Ma'am, you can share the screen now, ma'am.
Yeah, I'm sharing. I'm sorry, our computer is a little slow, so it takes a while. Yes. Can everybody see the screen? Hello?
Yeah,
hello?
We can see, Narendra. We can see, yes.
Visible.
Audible as well?
Yeah. Yes.
So I start off now. Just a brief overview on the whole objective of doing this quality program. It is just simple and straightforward. It is just to assure yourself that the tests that you have performed are as per the protocol, and the results that are obtained are not only reliable, but they are also reproducible. And the crux of the whole quality program is to safeguard the health of not only the recipient, but the donors and also the staff who are working in the laboratory. So basic elements of quality control in TTI is, first is foremost is the batch pre-acceptance testing of new batches. Whenever you get a new batch of kit, it has to be tested and evaluated to assure yourself that it is behaving the same way that your batch was behaving. Then assessment on the specific and sensitivity, usually this job is left to the reference lab. It is not for the end user. But if you are capable, then you could also go ahead and do it. Then there is something like internal QCs. Internal QCs are the quality controls that we have, the positive and the negative controls that have been provided by the manufacturer. And these have been
whose voice is coming through. Please, can you request everybody else to shut their mute their
Aikaj, please mute the others. Aikaj,
yes ma'am,
please. Yeah.
Okay, then after we have talked about the internal controls which are designed by the manufacturer for that particular assay, then we come to the external quality checks. This is just a means of confirming. Supposing if you get any unit reactive, then you have to, in case of doubt, you could always send it to your colleague or to any laboratory closer to you so that you can confirm whether it is positive. Then, of course, we have the external proficiency exercises, which are like we are one of the providers. Now in the country, there are three providers. So participating in these programs helps in assuring you of your performance. What is done is usually a panel of sera is circulated by the reference lab, who is already aware of values, and then you're supposed to run the panel, report the results to them, then the laboratory analyzes and then sends your report onto your performance. One moment, please. Just a moment, the slide is just stuck.
Ma'am, your sound is also not clear.
Not clear, is it? Okay, I bet. One moment.
There's a lot of echo happening.
Is it? Okay, slides are so. Did you sign up? Okay. And volume, they cannot hear. So,
Narendra, probably you can log in on your mobile and speak from there.
Now, is it audible? Yes, still echoing?
It's better. It's better.
Better. Are two things on?
No. Is that okay now?
Yeah, ma'am, go ahead. Much better.
Ma'am, go ahead. Please go ahead, please.
Okay, so then we come to the actually controls. What is quality control? This refers to the continual measures which must be undertaken for each essay to ensure that the test is working accurately as per the limits of the test so that we get valid and acceptable results. So the types of controls that we have is internal control, and as we all know, internal control and external control. Internal control is the one which comes with the pack, which is provided by the manufacturer, and external control is the one which we need to introduce, which could be manufactured either in-house or you could procure it from any provider. Maybe it may be a commercial one or any reference lab who would be doing the work. This is about the internal control, like I said, supplied with the kit, produced by the manufacturer, and we usually have two levels, that is the positive and negative, and they have to be run alongside the specimens, and they are compared with the predetermined criteria, which is laid down in the pack insert, so it has to fit into that criteria so that your run could be valid. Then coming to the external control, this, as the word suggests, it is external to the kit, but it cannot be a substitute for your internal control. It has to be used in addition to the kit controls, and they do not change lot to lot. Internal controls, with every lot, it comes separate, designed for that particular lot. While the external control, we produce it usually in the bulk, and it has to be used at least for 12 months. It is for a longer period, and they are manufactured independently of the kit, and they have to be tested on every run like you run your internal controls. So this, because they're manufactured in bulk and produced in large quantity and you can use it over a longer period of time, they will give you longitudinal information on the assay. Since they're run with the assay from batch to batch, various batches, it will give you an information on the assay, the consistency of its performance, and whether there is any lot-to-lot variation, just like the cookies in the picture, where there is a variation in the lot-to-lot batch. They can be used as go, no-go controls. But in order to do this, you have to have them to be run on various runs, more than 30 runs, then analyze them statistically and come to a figure which will come as a valid figure so that it can be used in addition to your internal controls to validate the test run. Where can you procure this QC samples? You can either make your own by selecting an appropriate diagnostic sample, and in case if you need larger volume, you can even pool the samples, or like any other laboratory who's doing so, maybe you could procure it from them, and maybe internationally as a participant to EQUIS program, the NRL Australia, they do provide with the controls. Or you could buy commercial products. We have commercial vendors who are giving these controls, but they are expensive. And another drawback being that the results are not collected by these manufacturers. So nor do they give any feedback, and nor are they designed for a specific assay. The important feature of this external QC sample is it has to be designed for that particular assay. You cannot be using QC, which is designed for J. Mitra on standard diagnostics, and you cannot interchange from hepatitis B to HCV. So it has to be all specifically done for the purpose. So these are usually low positive control. They are placed, the values are usually placed between the cutoff and the positive control value. It cannot be so close to the positive control value. If it goes close to the positive control value, it loses its very purpose, then it will not be able to pick up any little disturbances. It should be at a level where the variability can be picked up. You know, after we make the bulk solution, we plot a curve, we get a sigmoidal curve, and the linear portion of the sigmoidal curve, this at the point where the cutoff is located and the positive control is located, just a point over there where the value of this control is going to be about twice the cutoff value. That is the one we pick it up as the so-called quality control, and then it is run in various runs. Then we carry out stability studies and reproducibility studies before we make the batch ready for use. So the whole entire process consists of, like, when you fix upon a particular QC sample, you have to include it in all test runs. Essentially, at least minimum 30 runs it should be included in to plot a control chart. So once you have run it on 30 runs, then you derive at a mean and then calculate the standard deviation and then plus and two minus two standard deviation, and we determine the control limits for the behavior of that particular sample. And after all this data is collected, analysis is done, and then the sample is ready for use, and then we use it to monitor the variation day in and day out. So this is all about an overview on the QC program. Now, actually coming to implementing, how do you go about it? First of all, you have to have written policies of how the control will be prepared, how much quantity we need for the year, and the procedure of doing it. You need to design forms. Forms are something like, you know, the form of reporting for TTI, where you have the ODs and the sample cutoffs and the validation criteria and the positive and negative control values. These are the forms that need to be designed and to be used. Besides, most important being the training of the staff. Your staff has to be very well trained enough to understand. To begin with, they need to understand the concept and the reason behind doing what they are doing. Then you have to assure that there is complete documentation, and you need to review it from time to time. Maybe every time something new comes up, you need to review your decision. Select very good quality controls, then perform statistical analysis. Like I just said, we run it in 30 runs and then calculate the mean and then look for standard deviation. And then we develop the Levigenning chart. And Levigenning chart has to be reviewed every day. You get your run, you get your values, put it into the control chart and see how it looks. If it is fine, if it is within the limits, you go ahead. So what do we need to carry out this analysis? There are a number of tools that are available. These are called as statistical process control tools, and your laboratory personnel have to have basic statistics skills to analyze. If you are not good at mathematics, it becomes a little difficult to understand. Even if you're not good, you could develop those skills, and there are various methods. I believe you start with manual, start with graph and calculator, then you understand it better, rather than straight away putting it onto the computer and giving commands, and then you get it ready and you do not understand where things could go wrong. So essentially, this statistical process control tools are problem-solving tools that detect variation in a system, which can be reviewed, and it will help you in eliminating all the false results. They help us in achieving the stability in the whole process of testing and reduce the variation. If every day you're going to put your control values onto the control chart, you will understand how much is the variation and where you could have gone wrong. Most important is not only understanding, but trying to do a root cause analysis and then implementing the corrective action. So what are the other statistical process control tools that are available? I'm just enumerating them just for you to understand. There is histogram, like in hematology, we use the histograms. Then you have the bar diagrams where we compare the figures. Pareto charts, these are used to find the variability. Then we have the check sheets. Accountants use those tally sheets. And control charts, this is what is important for us. Then the cause and effect diagram, this is the fishbone diagram that we use for doing an RCA of any process failure. Flow charts are plenty used in our blood bank, in our blood centers, rather in the laboratories to indicate the procedure. And then the scatter diagrams. Of all this, we are only concerned with the control charts. Now, these are most commonly used tools, and examples of these are Shiwork, Levigenning, you have then WestGuard also. What is important in this is the sample cutoff ratio is plotted on the y-axis and the date is plotted on the x-axis. Then, like I said, you calculate the mean and standard deviation, and they are depicted on the graph. The mean is always in the center, and the standard deviation plus and minus two are indicated on the graph. And all that you have to do is put your sample cutoff at the level where it is supposed to be, I mean, whatever is the reading you have got. So this is a graph which you can actually see And when you can actually see, you will know where your value is placed, whether it is close to the 2SD or 3SD, or it is cross 2SD, and whether it is plus or minus 2SD, and then you know where you have gone wrong and a corrective action has to be initiated. It also helps you in identifying sometimes non-random patterns. You know, there are various types of errors which I've come to now. So when a system is in control, we will see usually equal number of points both above and below the mean value. There was a talk about P ratio. Now, what is so important about P ratio? Why don't we use directly the ODs or the optical density value of the sample? See, cutoff value of the run depends on that principle of that particular assay, the manufacturer guidelines, and the recommended protocol for calculation. Always when you run a plate, there is some degree of background noise. Now, what do you mean by this background noise is incubation period may vary from person to person. Preparation of reagents may vary. Plate to plate and well-to-well variation, coating of the antigen. Sometimes even holding the pipette varies. You know, so we say operator variation. You know, somebody else has operated today. So whatever may be this background noise, the OD of the controls, the control ODs will then influence the OD value of the test samples in the same direction. If the OD is going high, the sample OD will also go higher. But together, the relative reactivity of the given sample with the cutoff will not change. Their relationship is fixed. So this relative reactivity in a particular run, therefore, needs to be expressed as an E ratio, that is jointly in combination with the OD of sample and the cutoff. So that's the formula for it. I hope I'm clear on this. It's very important to understand. Just because of the background noise, we use this sample cutoff ratio. How do we prepare Levagenic charts? Now we have to include the QC sample before you use and say that your QC sample is ready now to be used in all the runs. You have to first validate it by running it at least on 30 runs using 3 different reagent batches and then plot it onto the graph. And like I said, after you have run, you have to calculate the mean and plus and minus 2 standard deviation, plot it on the graph. E ratios are on the y-axis and the dates are on the x-axis. And also identify the position at which the operator has changed or the batch has changed, and all the results should be displayed, including your invalid runs. Sometimes your run may be invalid. Don't think that you don't need to put on it, but you need to put on it. That's where you will be able to identify your problems. Plot the control values of each run and then make decision regarding the acceptability of the run based on the values that you have assigned. Always monitor it over a period of time to evaluate the precision and accuracy of repeated measurement. These are two terminologies, precision and accuracy. So you have to review your charts and defined intervals and take necessary actions and then document. So this is an example that I'm giving you. See, this is the number of runs that we have had, 31 runs. And these are the E ratios for each run, you know, of the control, external control that you have run, the E ratios. So what you do is you need to take the mean of this E ratios, that is addition of all this E ratio divided by number of readings. And this is what you get the mean as 1.78, okay? Now, once you have got the mean, what you need to find out is the deviation of each reading from the mean. The mean is 1.78 and each is coming to like this. So you need to calculate the deviation. So these are the deviation values. It's these many times, this is the deviation that has happened from the average value. Then eventually you square these deviations and then we calculate the standard deviation. This is by the formula. This is just, actually everything is available on the computer. You can use those tools. But then since it's readily available, we don't really apply our mind. So this is just to elaborate how it is done. So standard deviation, we calculate by taking a square root divided by n minus 1, the number of readings. And then we set the upper limit. Upper limit, the formula is mean plus 2 into standard deviation. and lower limit is mean minus 2 into standard deviation, and then we get these values, and then we also calculate the coefficient of variation, that is standard deviation divided by mean into 100. This is exactly saying the same thing what I have told you now. What is important is the coefficient of variation less than 10 is considered to be an indication of little variation. Any increase in CV means there is variability of results and you need to carry out your RCA.
So I'm interrupting you in between.
Okay, I'll just rush through. There's not much left now. Anyway, in general, laboratories use plus and minus 2 SD criteria. So most of the times our QC values fall within the 95.5% confidence interval. It's only 4.5% of the time that it goes beyond that. And this is accuracy and precision. I don't think I will talk on this. Just this slide, this shows the bullseye. Here you will see that this is the accurate path and this is the reading scattered. So there is no precision, no accuracy. And here they're all at least together, but away from the accurate reading. So this is low accuracy, high precision. Here they're accurate, but less precise, and here it is both. So this is just to illustrate our leveraging chart. Last year during pandemic, it's a 6-month chart, which we did not have many runs. So you can see this is from March till January. And this is how actually the ideal pattern should look like. So I'm happy that we had this pattern. So this is just to illustrate how these are the outliers, something which has gone above the SD. So the moment it goes above the SD, you need to understand what it is, whether there is a new operator or a change in batch. So what is the application? It helps to understand whether there are any systematic variations or random variations or lot-to-lot variations or change in operator, day-to-day or change in SA or this thing. So systematic variations, they go in a systematic way. And any systematic way, variation is because of a fault in your process. You have not run the SA properly, or it could be because of the reagent issues. So these are the two important ones, the trend and shift. Trend is something that moves. Am I supposed to stop?
Yeah, so this
this is a trend and this is a shift. But then if this is not conveyed, it doesn't.
I understand,
Okay, so it's okay. This is the shift. The reason for shift being switching to new lot of kits, new reagents, changes in incubation temperature, and 6 consecutive shifts in one direction, we need to analyze. Random is because of transcription error, sample mix-up, poor pipette precision, poor mixing of samples, and reader not being calibrated or washing being inconsistent. So sometimes we have hot kits and sometimes we have lower absorbance kits. So how they look and how they behave. So you can all pick it up from this Levy-Jennings chart. And Westgaard rules, really, we do not use much in blood banking, although yes, they can be used, but specifically used when 2 levels of controls are run. And they have 6 different control rules to judge the acceptability. 3 are mandatory and other 3 are warning. And only best part of Westgaard is even the smaller shifts in the process, you can pick it up easily. But these are more so often used in high volume chemistry and hematology instruments so that we do not have a very high rejection rate. This is the chart how when you have 1-2S, it is just a warning. But 1-2S in combination with any of this, you will have to reject your run. And I think that's about it. Thank you.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you very much for the nice talk. Sorry, we are running late. I will proceed further. Now I invite Dr. Lata ma'am. Please introduce our next speaker for today, Dr. Jaiswal, Dr. Ram Mohan Jaiswal. Dr. Lata ma'am, please.
My pleasure to introduce Dr. Jaiswal. He is a professor director at the Blood Center and Transplant Immunology Lab and in the Mahatma Gandhi Medical College Hospital in Jaipur. He developed the state-of-art transplant immunology lab over there. So other than transfusion medicine, he has done a lot of work in transplant immunology. He's been awarded by various agencies. He belongs to so many of these ISBT, ISTM, and so on. And I would like to ask him to start now quickly. I don't want to waste any more time.
Sure, ma'am. Thank you very much for your kind words. Just I am going to share my screen.
Yes, sir. You can share now.
Yes.
So please, I just request you to please.
My screen is visible now?
Not yet.
Not visible.
Okay.
Yeah, it's visible now.
Okay, once again, thank you and thanks for giving the opportunity to share my experience on the quality assurance. Though much about the quality and TTI testing already discussed by the expert panelist, and nothing is left for me, but still just I have to present my this talk as a report. As we know, the topmost requirement of any blood transfusion services is do not harm to the recipient as well as donor. And for this, blood safety, transfusion safety process involves loss of most of the thing which encompasses quality control, quality assurance, and quality management system. And to the our main aim to reduce the risk of transfusion-transmitted infection. And for this, we have to follow, and the, this thing should be started from the donor screening. And first, we have to check the proper donor eligibility criteria for donation process, processing, then quality control, various screening tests, then storage, indication for transfusion, and in the last, traceability and hemovigilance system. What are the different strategies? And these strategies start from the decision to transfuse. At one end, we are starting our process from the donor screening. In another end, from the clinical point of view, decision to transfuse. The patient, the judicious use of blood, that is the one of the most important thing when we are thinking about this, this patient is required transfusion or not. So from the both end, from the donor perspective and from the recipient perspective, it is a complete blood transfusion, making a complete blood transfusion chain. As we know, this is a very common diagram where quality management system, which tells about effective quality system to achieve quality objectives, then quality assurance to provide confidence that a product or service will fulfill requirements for the quality, and quality control to ensure that a product or service attain the required level or higher of quality. And of course, the our main aim for today's session is the testing, and everything for the proper testing and quality testing, we require all these systems, proper quality management system, then quality assurance, and then quality control. The quality assurance cycle is having various pre-analytical and analytical variables as well as post-analytical variables. These variables may occur in the form of patient, donor, sample preparation, then personal competency of our technician, then sample receipt, then quality control testing, then record keeping, and then reporting. So it makes a complete quality assurance cycle, and each part in this quality assurance cycle is having equal importance. And when we are discussing about quality assurance, it is a part of quality management system, which focused on providing confidence that quality requirements will be fulfilled, creation and operation of standards, program, and effective management system to ensure quality, and means by which the laboratory ensures that the final results reported are correct and are achieved in a standard, reproducible, and traceable manner. Basically, why we are talking about the quality assurance, when we are implementing quality assurance, so it is the basically to avoid mistakes, consistency of our right performance, maintaining the data integrity, efficiency of cost effectiveness, and user satisfaction, as well as most important, blood center esteem and credibility. An appropriate test on the correct samples, accurate results are obtained by this testing methodology, by various testing methodology, as we our expert panel discuss about the various testing methodology, rapid test, CLIA test, ELISA test. But the most important thing where we are, where these tests we are used for. Because as we know, these testing are having different quality control system. As suppose if you are doing CLIA testing, so I think in CLIA we are not using any kind of E-ratio. Only screen non-reactive blood and blood components are released. screen blood and blood components are available in the blood inventory at all the times. And it is the, again, one of the most important factor. If any blood which is not tested in your blood bank, it considered as a no use of any recipient. So the process control which ensures all these things comes under the quality assurance of our testing, transfusion testing services. When we are talking about quality assurance, we must know about what is the quality system and what is the basic difference between quality assurance and quality system. Quality system, quality assurance, and quality management system are integrated to each other. By definition, they are having different implication. As we are, when we are talking about the quality system, so it focused is a defined part of quality management which fulfilling quality requirements. And it is the monitoring system that ensures that specification are met and errors do not occur in terms of testing. Check effectiveness of quality assurance by testing and quality of final product. When we are talking about quality assurance, though, we took the example of our fundamental standards of American Association of Blood Bank, because most of the thing, technical things are discussed. I am taking one by one in one or two slides, what are the importance of the whole process, whole cycle ranging from organization to your facility. Organization, any legal responsible, any person who is legally authorized by the organization to take this activity is responsible, and this is governed by your organization. It provides the managerial and technical person who have the resources and authority needed to carry out the assigned functions, and responsible for assigning responsibilities, ensuring a smooth interrelationship of personnel who manage, perform, and verify the laboratory activities. Basically, it consists of organogram, and everyone is well aware of what is the organogram. And the second part is the resources. In resources, when we are talking about the resources, resources in terms of spaces, resources in terms of personnel, resources in terms of materials, and resources in terms of TTI lab. These all things are very important. Person should be competent enough. All the material should be in the proper receiving, accepting criteria in a proper way. You have a proper policy to accept or reject your testing reagents. And for these things, everything should be documented in a proper manner in your SOP or in your quality system, whatever you follow. Then equipment. Equipment is again one of the major part. Proper management and calibration is not only the mere presence of equipment is important, but the proper management and calibration is equally very important, because though if you are having very good system, if it is not calibrated, if it is not properly managed, it is not going to give you accurate and reliable result. Backup equipment is essential, because as we are aware, as a policy, we have to, our backup system, if one system is not working, we have to switch to second methodology or second lab. Sometimes we are not having our backup equipment at our facility. So in that condition, we have to prior MOU with the nearby labs or nearby blood center who can back you in these type of conditions. An extra set of vital parts of equipment must be kept aside in the TTI lab and available for immediate replacement. And of course, we already discussed alternative test methods. As we know, right now we are facing the dengue condition going up very rapidly in our city. So in that condition, we have policy to maintain in our documented policy. Suppose if we are having less time, if we are not able to cope with the clear testing, so we are using rapid in these condition after informing the concerned clinicians and after proper counseling of the donor. And then again, we have to maintain all the parameters to maintain good equipment, like identity of equipment, manufacturers. And I think those blood banks who already NABH accredited are, and even those who are not accredited with the NABH, these systems are common for everyone, because it already mentioned in our NACO training program, and to maintain all the quality parameters. So these things are very important, why we are maintaining our equipment in terms of need. And then quality system essential for in terms of supplier. Our supplier should be validated, reputed, and authorized distributors. he should not be blacklisted, he or she should not be blacklisted in terms of supplying the materials in time of need. So these all parameters are very important when we are talking about the quality assurance system. Then process control, as sir already discussed and posed very beautiful picture of 5M, that is the man, material, machinery, methodology, and mother nature. Of course, these are all 5Ms are very important to maintain and in process control and in the quality assurance system or quality assurance cycles. Right equipment, right resin, right person, and right environment and right procedure. Suppose if our input is right, we have to follow all this process. If our process is perfect, then of course we can say we can say confidently our output will be perfect. Then suppose name on scope of the test, when we are mentioning in the process control, we have to validate in a proper way. Name of the procedure, by which method we are doing, by ELISA or by CLIA or by NAT, though NAT is a optional test, and whenever we require NAT, ELISA and CLIA is must do test. So we can't say NAT is the only NAT test. We can't take name as in obsolete or in isolation. NAT must be accompanied by the ELISA or CLIA. Collection, transport, storage, and inventory management of the specimen, these are all very important parameters. Process control, already in terms of, I already discussed in terms of one beautiful figure. And this is the validity criteria of test done, as already our previous speaker already told in very detail what is the internal control and what is the cutoff. This is the batch validation. Again, documents and records. Again, this is a very important part. There are four level of documents: policy document, process description document, procedure document, and records. These all, if we follow all these things, then we can say we are having good quality assurance system at our blood center. I am rushing my slide just because of time. Then deviation and non-conformance. Policies and procedure must be in place to identify such occurrence when any aspect of the test analysis or function does not conform the laid down procedures. Procedure must be in place to analyze the non-conformity and take corrective and preventive action. Records of detection of non-conformity, root cause analysis. These are the very important parameter when we are dealing with any kind of test, not TTI. Even in our normal process, we have to monitor all these things. Then assessment, we had to do regular assessment of our blood center in the terms of internal quality control, internal validation, as well as external quality control. And the main purpose of external quality control is the assessment of laboratory performance, and each laboratory should participate in ICWAS to check their performance, where they lie. Suppose if you are doing CLIA and someone is doing ELISA, we have to see at the end of our ICWAS result, our result should be consistent with the standard what the test is meant for. Then process improvement. This is the continuous process. The goal of process is improvement in provision of high quality services. Results are achieved through a process that describes desired performance, identify gaps between desired and actual performance. And one thing I would like to highlight, quality indicators, because when we are talking about the process and continuous improvement, so these are the parameters by which we can say confidently, we can assess on which direction we are going. So these are the indicators which already mentioned, which is mentioned in NABH standards, percentage of TTI and percentage of component formation, donor deferral rate. And in this context, when we are talking about TTI, so TTI percentage and TTI outliers are important. Then facilities and safety. The TTI laboratory must provide adequate facility for the personnels working in the TTI so that they work in a safe environment. All biohazard material coming out of the TTI laboratory must be discarded in keeping with the national guidelines and biomedical waste management rules. I'm just finishing here by take home message. Write what you do, do what you write. Because documentation is one of the key component of quality assurance, quality management system, and quality control. And of course, quality cost, but poor quality cost more than low quality. By these things, I am just ending here, and I'm taking my references from the training manual of NAPO, NABH standard, and the fundamental standards of AAB. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
I think, Ravi, I am on time.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Please. Now proceeding further, I request Dr. Jayashree Sharma, ma'am, to please introduce our next speaker, Dr. Sangeeta Pathak.
It's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Sangeeta Pathak, who has been associated with her for quite many years. And there is no need actually to introduce Dr. Sangeeta is all in one, a very versatile, dynamic personality and a well-known figure nationally, internationally. And she has received various awards, and she has been a recipient of all this Max Chair, Healthcare Chairman's Award, J.D. Jolly Award, Dr. Usha Gupta Award, Sushita Award, and many awards and many publications also she has to her credit, and many presentations Dr. Sangeeta has given in national, international forums. And the best thing is she has pioneered the convalescent plasma therapy for COVID patient treatment in India, which had really helped our country at that time, because that time there was no treatment as such, you know, nothing was working, and the plasma was the only thing which was working, and you really showed a way for the entire country how to go about plasma therapy. So now coming to the topic which you are going to discuss, it's really a very important topic. And the various health economic benefits of NAT on blood donors and recipients. And for centers like us, public centers, public hospitals, it's really a very tough situation, where, you know, we want to do it, but because of cost factors and all those things, you know, it's taking time, and government is a little hesitant to, you know, introduce, implement this. So it would be really very nice if you can throw light on this issue, health economic benefits, and how to, you know, like how to go about in a low cost efficient, cost effective manner. And because it's a need of the hour, and we really have to go for this. So you can really guide us like how you have always been guiding us throughout. So that will be very nice. So please, without me wasting any time, I want you to start the topic. Thank you so much, Dr. Sangeeta, for giving me an opportunity to be a part of this session, esteemed and a very enlightening session. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for this over kind introduction for me, and I'll start because I suppose I'm already too means it's already 4:30. And yeah. Ravi, can I share my screen?
Yeah, ma'am, you can share.
Have you given me those rights?
Yeah, you can share, ma'am. No problem.
Okay, just give me 2 minutes.
We don't have 2 minutes.
I don't have, so I'll start speaking only. I'll start speaking jaldi se na desktop pe here. Okay, can you see my this?
Yes.
Yeah,
can you see my slides?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'll be talking on this health economic benefits of NAT, and it is a very interesting topic. But now I'm actually main thodi panic ho gayi hu kyunki time nahi hai. So I don't know how I'm going to finish it, but I started fast. Greeting from this hospital. I have 14 hospitals, and I work with the flagship branch at Saket, New Delhi. And blood, we all know, is safer than ever, and transfusions save many lives each year. But still, the high seroprevalence of transfusion-transmitted diseases among the blood donors is there. Hepatitis B remains the major threat among hepatitis C and HIV in India. Of the 118 million blood collections, collecting about 10 to 12 million. And out of the 13,300 blood centers, we have more than 3,000 in India. So the problem lies in India with the funds, the scattered blood centers, and the unfocused attitude of the government towards the blood banks. So again, this is a slide which is always bought. So what is serology missing? Serology is actually missing this. We are starting from year and serology is missing this entire thing. So NAT is covering it now from year, but this eclipse period, which is now, which still misses, has to be covered. Then the occult HBV cases are a problem, and the mutants are a problem again, which are again not detectable. Then we have come a long way from evolution of TTI screening, from with doing the surrogate markers to right now doing the viral, means picking up the virus itself. Now also the pathogen inactivation, though it is not very, very, means it is not popular right now in India, but soon I suppose we would be also starting with it. So why not in India? So many things, like the high NAT yield with so many HIV, HCV, HBV. So definitely contributing to 10% of the world's HBV infected population, and being a country with a high incidence of these infections, a significant number of window period donations can be identified by NAT. And currently out of these 10 to 12 million, it's only 1 to 1.2 million are NAT tested. So request to everyone to change this 1 million to at least 2 million, whoever is listening to me right now. With increase in awareness, many states are looking to initiate pilot NAT programs to understand the benefit it brings to the society. So here, what I'm bringing is actually for the government, it is not benefiting as such to the hospital, but to the state governments and the government more beneficial to them. So I'm just bringing it up. Like, this was a paper that I bought, prevalence of TTI post-conventional serology and NAT PCR testing. This paper recently came out, and we did a study on 1.88 lakh donations. And the study period was 1st Jan 2015 to 31st December 2019. In serology, we got these yields, which are on the left-hand side. I don't have the time to show narrate them each. And on the right-hand side, I have the NAT yields, which HBV was 87, HCV was 9, HIV was 1, and overall my NAT yield was 1 in 1600. And 1,88,000 samples were taken. Out of that, 155 were tested, because the others were either SDPCs or the RDPCs, which were given out in emergency. So this was a paper brought out by one of our colleagues, and she showed in that in 2017 how the economic benefits come out. And here she had studied on the HBV. And HBV, she studied that about 15 lakhs into three times could have been saved if one-time cost of NAT had been taken. And she finally brought it out that one-time cost of NAT PCR tested blood bag is more, or the cost of treatment is more. So here we can't argue on whether it is being helpful to the hospital and to you. It is helpful to the entire economy of the country. So this was understanding the health economic benefits of NAT. And these were the three key terminologies which were used in it. And the first one was cost benefit, treatment cost saved. That was cost benefit calculated on treatment cost saved and the disability affected life years, which were averted for TTIs, averted by NAT. Second was this disability affected life years, that is DELIS. And this was calculated on based on residual risk with serology screening alone versus serology and NAT screening. Then the incremental cost effective ratio. This was ICR based on residual risk calculated basis on the respective window period of serology and NAT. And this is a WHO recommended methodology. And in this, it has been said, so the ICR has been utilized to compare the cost effectiveness of NAT testing vis-a-vis a non-NAT testing. And classification of the cost effectiveness of ICR is based on comparison with the GDP per capita statewide. And this has been divided into three parts, like highly cost effective and not cost effective. So if we take India's GDP as 1,45,000, the ICR that I calculated out of my this study that I did was -27,658. So it falls under highly cost effective, which was if ICR is less than the average GDP per capita. And cost effective was if ICR is between 1 to 3 times average per capita GDP. And not cost effective was if ICR was more than 3 times per capita average GDP. So I'm rushing on it, but I don't know means what to do because I needed to explain everything to you, but I can't. Now the NAT implementation in a more graphic form, we took 1,88,000 donations per tested, then estimated 100% of the blood units were further split into 3 components. Then we took it as that reproduction of 1:1 considered, that is every infected recipient would at least infect one or more person in his lifetime. And we saw that we could avert 1,952 incremental TTI cases were averted. This amounted to 16,578 Delhis which were averted. And the graph that I'm showing here is, this is the value. This is the 16 crore investment. Someone is talking, please mute. So 16 crores were invested by us here for the NAT in these 5 years. So I've put it as minus. And 62 crores cost was saved if the recipients would have been infected. So this 62 crores were saved. Then this is the unseen cost that was saved, 242 crores, that is savings from 16,578 Delhis averted if the person was infected and had not gone to work. It is that unseen cost has come. And 287 amounts to minusing, means plusing 242, 62 minusing 16, so it comes out to be 287 crores, a huge cost. Then I would just like to come on this slide, implementation of NAT. In this, we the cost effectiveness study for NAT screening was done over 5 years, and the result came out as 1,952 infected cases averted due to TTI, and this was due to identification of all zero negative donors for HCV, HBV, and subsequent reproduction through the infected cases. Then the Delhis that were averted were 16,578. That is, the disability adjusted life years are a measure of the overall disease burden, measuring the combined quality and quantity of life of a population. Then 14,414 deaths were averted. So out of the cases that we had, not all would go to live. Many of them would abort the treatments in between, and many of them would lose life. So this in the calculations were 1,414 deaths were averted, and about 62 crores were saved over a lifetime due to NAT savings, NAT testings. Then about these, just to summarize, I had a lot.
Dr. Sangeeta, you got mute or what?
Already cut short while the other speakers were. Is it? No, I'm not mute.
Your screen was frozen for a while.
Fine. Now it's okay?
Yeah, it's fine. You got frozen for a while.
I'm rushing. No, itna mereko tense kar diya tum logon ne. So NAT tested, jaldi karo, okay. NAT tested blood benefits patient and country on the whole year. I have shown that the country is benefiting, and this particular health economic cohort was actually designed and tested for the states also to take this NAT. Then safe blood supply critical for thalassemics, not only thalassemics, but also multi-transfused patients who are most vulnerable population due to frequent blood transfusions. And a standardized NAT testing, proven technology and methodology can go a long way in improving the safe blood supply in India. Now, anyone who wants to connect me, these figures are very dicey figures. We've been calculating them with great difficulty, with a lot of technique. So because I was short of time here, I was cut short to not even 10 minutes. So I have not presented all that. Anyone who wants to connect to me directly can connect. And I'm thankful for the time that has been given to me. Thanks a lot. I hand over the mic to the chairpersons. Thank you.
Rush.
Much.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot for being on time. We will proceed now. Thank you.
May I say, as a chairperson, I have a right to make one or two comments here. Yes, NAT definitely is beneficial. It is an added safety layer. But in India, I think we should start looking from donor screening, quality of testing everywhere. We have not done that. Our NAT yield is going to be very high. We do NAT. All our units are tested. But I'm saying this is going to add unnecessary cost if those steps are not looked at. We have said it every time, each and every time, if we don't look at centralization, and the government has to do it. So we have to do something about it as a body.
So this actually study was done for the state governments to realize that how much investment is being saved, and we will be showcasing this. I'm going to publish this also. And this shows a huge amount of benefit for all of us. It shows, actually.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, chairpersons. Thank you, Dr. Lata. Thank you, Dr. Jayashree. We will proceed further now. We will have a quiz now. We have the quiz master, the most dynamic quiz master with us, Dr. Aker Jindal. Everybody knows him. I will not give much intro of him. Nobody is like that. He doesn't know him. He is a head of the department, Transformation and Space Hospital, Ludhiana at present. I think so, Dr. Akash, over to you, please.
Thank you, sir. I'll be very quick. I can see the speakers before me were rushed. I will just take a few seconds. There will be 5 questions each, 30 seconds for each question. Maximum right answers shall have the, and the earliest will be the winner. In case there's a tie, tiebreaker question will be asked separately. The quickest right answer shall win. You have to submit the quiz at the end by pressing the submit button. If you do not submit, your attempt shall not be recorded. In case it is interrupted due to any technical glitch, software, power failure, internet connection disruption, Atom India is not liable.
Responsible. Can I add something?
Please, ma'am, please go ahead.
The entire 98 people who are seeing this can attend it. It's not for the under 40. Please.
Ma'am, for us all.
Please pardon me for this. We had a very energetic video from Dr. Sangeeta, encouraging everybody. I'll not be playing it because we are running very short on time. Ma'am really infused enthusiasm in us last time. All members are requested to update their Zoom in case of any dispute. Whatever Dr. Sangeeta says will be considered final. The winner shall be awarded as per the Atom policy. With this, I shall be opening up the quiz and get your phones, laptops ready. The quiz is on your screens now. Which of the following is the correct order of serological appearance from first to last for hepatitis B virus?
Your screen is not shared. Akash, your screen is not getting shared.
No, we can see it.
Ma'am, we can see, ma'am.
No, not here.
Laptop kharab hai.
Thank you.
Moving on to the next question. Which of the following accurately describes Westgaard 2-2S rules? In case you were not following what the panel discussion and the previous talk had, this question will be a problem for you. Mm-hmm. Third question, what is incorrect regarding residual risk for transfusion-transmitted infections? The estimated risk, I will not read out the options, just to save more time. Question number 4, Which of the following is incorrect about cytomegalovirus?
Your screen is stuck in the first one.
Yeah.
No, ma'am, you have to move as per your speed.
Oh, I see. Okay, sorry.
As you keep on attempting questions, please go on moving to the next. Once you end to the last question, there will be a button of submit on it.
हमें देख ही नहीं रहा हम अटेम्प्ट ही नहीं कर सकते हैं यू हैव मेड अस आउट
नो मैम नॉट मी बट Zoom Zoom has this functionality ma'am
सॉरी डियर
व्हिच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग इज इनकरेक्ट अबाउट साइटोमेगालोवायरस इवन आफ्टर द क्लियरेंस ऑफ CMV इंफेक्शन द वायरस रिमेन्स लेटेंट Leukoreduction is an effective way to reduce risk of CMV-TTI. CMV can be transmitted through cellular blood components. In immune-competent individuals, CMV leads to fatal disease. Coming to the last question, as per NBTC guidelines regarding Zika virus, the donors returning from an endemic area are deferred for how many days? We can see 20 people have submitted so far. I mean, that is simply amazing. We have 8 seconds more. Please submit your quiz. If you do not submit, it is not taken. And the time is up now. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Akash. Thank you very much for the quiz. Dr. Shivram, I will invite Dr. Shivram now. For the question and answer, we will take just few questions. Dr. Shivram, please, sir.
Yes, yes. I think we will just take two questions because we are running out of time. I think some questions have already come in. There is one from Nidhi Sharma. While preparing in-house controls, can we use the same standard deviation across the batches, across different batches? Who will take this? Dr. Narinder Naidu or Dr. Ram Jaiswal, anybody? Hello?
Yes. Yes, sir.
The question is, can you use the same internal control across batches, what we have prepared?
Sir, we can't use for across the batches, but it is the good practice if we use validate our internal control with the control provided by the batches. If we once validate our internal control with the control which is provided by the batch, then we can use across the batches.
Okay, Dr. Narinder Naidu, any differing opinion?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, we can hear you.
See, internal control is the one which comes with the pack. So it has to be used for the pack only. You cannot change it to the other batches. So that is why we have designed this external control.
This is not internal control, in-house controls that you have prepared.
In-house controls, in-house yes. Controls. You have prepared, yes, you
Correction,
can.
I do not know what I read earlier. It is in-house controls that we have created. Yes, it needs to be used across batches.
Yes, yes. It is designed to be used across batches. Like I said, it is prepared in large volume and you can use it for a longer period. And that is how it will give you information, longitudinal information on the performance of that assay.
Okay, thank you. So as Dr. Ram said, internal controls cannot be interchanged, but in-house controls can be interchanged across batches. The purpose of calculating E-ratio is to negate the other effects. Then we have one more question, how to store this one. This one I will not ask it. A good way would be just to prepare aliquots and keep it. Then there is one more question to Dr. Sangeeta Pathak. What is your comment regarding using a combination of NAT and rapid testing in blood bank? Dr. Sangeeta?
Yeah. So you have to use it as per your requirements. NAT and combination of NAT and rapid, I don't know what it is, but still when NAT is not being run, like in our settings in Delhi, we have a state ruling that we have to do a 4-generation test. So
let me put it this way. See, NAT is done. For some reason, ELISA or CLIA is not done. So can we do a rapid and issue it?
I would not.
Why?
I would not issue it because the basic serology test has to be done. We are not sitting in remote villages where a rapid would be done and a NAT would be done and then issued. No, I would not do it. I would do a proper serology because that is covered in DNC Act and we have to do that. So I'll do a serology on top of that, if I don't have a NAT, I'll prefer doing a rapid because a fourth generation is available in it. Okay, so I'll do rapid.
Dr. Sadhana is also raising her hand. Dr. Sadhana and followed by actually, Dr. Makru.
No, actually, whatever the slide has been shown by you in your panel discussion about the sensitivity, the rapid are less sensitive, we all know. So one side, we are choosing the less sensitive test and on other side, we are choosing the most sensitive test. So how we are going to do in between? So this is because it was already discussed in your panel discussion, sir.
So you say we should not be giving it without a proper serology test. Dr. Makru?
Am I audible?
Yes, perfectly.
Basically, but there is something wrong with your slide. Firstly, I must compliment all of you that you have a very good classroom type of the teaching. Well, the most important thing is because basically, as regards, there are centers where there are very few samples. Well, they are doing the rapid test, which is even a fourth generation. Well, they can go ahead. Well, it is not because as per the law, even by the Drug and Cosmetic Act, they can do a rapid test. And whereas, because basically, these are all serological tests. It is rapid test and ELISA test, both are serological tests. And so there is not variation. Well, as regards the NAT is a different version that is primarily to cover the window period transmission. And so that is a slightly different to improve the blood safety. That is all my comment. And as regards, because you had asked what option you have, practically the biggest problem with the country is that we are having walking donor program, especially for the platelets. We don't have the platelets STPs on the shelf. What basically most of the centers in the developed countries, they have even the SDPs on the shelf, whereas we have a walking donor program. And so majority of the centers, well, those who have the ECIs, well, they are doing the random, ELISA testing, otherwise they are doing the rapid testing. Thank you.
I just want to say that there are many blood banks keeping SDP on the shelf. Yes, Dr. Lata.
Dr. Lata. Yeah. So, according to DNC Act, we can do rapid or CLIA or ELISA. Now, the only thing, if you use a rapid and a NAT, what would happen is you would get a bigger NAT yield because the rapid is supposedly less sensitive. So that is my take on this. But,
ma'am, there's one thing, because basically most of the time it said the rapid is less sensitive. There are so many studies where rapid has shown they are not less sensitive. They pick up. They pick up and they have false positivity. Their sensitivity is very good, but they are not specific. They give a lot of false positive results.
So the message is clear. Even when you have done NAT, you would still depend on a good serological test and not barely on a rapid test.
Because the rapid test is highly sensitive, but not specific. And it does not hardly misses. And this has been seen time and again with so many presentation and papers. Because it is almost, they say sometimes it is over 100. So it picks up the majority, and that's why it gives a lot of false positive results.
Yes, I agree with sir that rapids are quite sensitive at times. So it depends on the type of rapid and the quality of rapid that is being used. Of course, long ago, there used to be rapids which were really bad. Off late, there are very good rapids and they are sensitive enough to pick up. And you get false positives, but false negative is very rare.
Okay, so that's our discussion. Thanks, everybody. Yeah. Thanks to AATM. Over to Dr. Ravi.
Yeah, thank you all, please. Now we'll proceed to next. I will invite Dr. Nidhi Mehta now. Dr. Nidhi Mehta, she is the Chief Laboratory and she is the Consultant at Chief Laboratory and Transfusion Services, MGCM, Comprehensive Thalassemia Care, Pediatric Hemato-Oncology Bone Marrow Transplant Center at Borivali, Mumbai. She was the ex-consultant transfusion services Kokila Ben Dinomani Hospital, Mumbai. She is the vice chairperson for the India chapter ATOM. She has many publications to her credit. She has also received an award of excellence in the field of transfusion medicine by SBTI. I welcome her, ma'am.
Thanks, Ravi. So I am given the task of vote of thanks. And at the first end, I would like to announce the results for the quiz the most interesting part of the event, for which I will not comment on the age, but everybody waits. So the winner of the quiz today is Dr. Saurabh Lahare. So congratulations, Dr. Saurabh. And it's a pleasure moment that we are half an hour delayed for the event, but still 72 participants are logged in. I would like to thank everybody who's put in efforts to organize this event, right from all the ATOM team members, the speakers, chairpersons, and moderators, everyone here, and nonetheless, our quiz master. Also, I would like to thank our sponsors, Roche and Abbott. So thank you all for attending the event. Thank you.
Okay, thank you everybody. We'll leave now.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Mask on, Abhi sir.